to make it last.
Oh, you got it.
And the second one that I, by N.M. Silver, both of these are authors. I want to develop some hobbies. So far, I hadn't really developed any. But I did have a growing collection of empty wine bottles. Got Gail's attention. That could be a hobby. And I had bookmarked several articles on making your own soap, in case you know soap wasn't readily available. Please stand for the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Mr. President.
Thank you, Tony. Is there any business that we have forgotten from last week or a couple of weeks since we've been gone for a while? Yes, ma'am.
I don't think we've forgotten anything. Gloria wasn't here, I don't think, last week. We are having elections next week, and the slate of officers is Mark Lockery for president, Susan Morgan, vice president of education, Tim Rickey, vice president of membership, Stephen Morgan, Vice President of Public Relations, Tony Goodall, Secretary, Jay Majors. Really want to go to Morgan. As our treasurer and John Dunn, Sergeant at Arms. We've worked it out, so we will have a quorum for the election, and we will have some, you know, nobody's running against anyone, but we will have short speeches, as this is another way for us to get some opportunity, and then we'll have our regular meeting. And we do need somebody to...
Is the regular meeting going to be abridged?
Well, two speakers, probably. We do need someone to run the election part of the meeting. Are you going to be here?
Yeah. I will be.
Would you be interested in doing that?
Yeah.
My question is,
yes,
if I sign up for Toastmaster next week, is it going to be a normal
session? It'll be a shorter meeting, because the elections will take 20 minutes at least.
So maybe I'll wait till a full meeting, or is it easier?
It's up to you, whatever you like. You'll be doing exactly the same thing, except you'll have a little bit shorter period. You know, if there's a theme you want to expand on, you won't have a lot of time to talk about the theme.
Might be
so
better.
Anybody that doesn't want a lot of time to talk about a theme, you should be Toastmaster.
Well, it might be better for a first time.
Yeah.
All right, so let me plan on next week. The theme will be May the Force Be With You, or something like that.
Okay.
You can come in costume.
Star Wars.
Okay. Well, at the end of the meeting, we'll review the schedule for next week, and there's a sign. Emma should be passing.
It's over there.
Okay. So please circulate the sign-up sheet, and then we'll review that and give you another chance to finalize the thing.
Where's over there?
Thank you. That's all I know of Charlie.
He's in charge
Okay. Thank you.
And then just other point of business.
Yeah.
The following week, we're going to have the installation banquet. Susan is our chairman. I'm our food chairman. And I'm circulating a sign-up food and beverage list for anybody who has not seen it. And so I will get that at the end of the night.
Thank you, Gail.
Thanks.
Tony Giddles has been a member of CFF for 11 years. Since her retirement and between caregiving duties, she has been looking for new hobbies and community service activities to fill her time. Back in August, she came across a jigsaw puzzle in a mail order catalog, revitalizing her childhood interest in jigsaw puzzles. Since then, she has put together over 25 puzzles and recently started framing some. The first one she framed was a Halloween scene which she put out in the yard for all the trick-or-treaters to enjoy. She has made several puzzles for friends and is currently sending a puzzle of antique toys to her friend in Chicago who is an antique toy collector. Here to lead us in the theme meeting of Hobbies I Love, please welcome distinguished Toastmaster Tony Giddles.
Thank you for being here, and those of you that are doing double duty, thank you, thank you, thank
with you. Right, I think, did you agree to do double duty?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Of course.
Gloria? Would you have a role, Gloria? Did you?
I'm just doing.
We're going to back out of time.
I'm going to be down for table topics.
Okay, awesome. Thank you for putting that in order. Well, I have been putting together puzzles since August and avoiding any other thing I should have been doing instead because it's very addicting. It's like computer games and eating and drinking wine and all the good stuff. But it's been very calming for me. And I get to watch my TV shows, I relax, the dog sits next to me. I'm usually up till 4 a.m., so Charlie, when you send me a text at 9, that's not a problem, it's not late. But I'm having so much fun, and I got the idea to frame them so that I could share them with people and kind of redecorate the house. And my mom was over yesterday, and she enjoyed it, so I'm going to be putting a puzzle together for her that we're going to frame and start redecorating her little place, too. Let's go through the functionaries before I forget to do that. Mr. Grammarian. Come on, everybody.
Grammarian is the word of the day, which is ecstasy.
Okay.
I'll keep track of those who use the word of the day. Those who have a chance to speak and do not use the word of the day will be fined 25 cents. Guest members who have not yet given their icebreaker speech will not be fined. No problems here in this room. I will also list for colorful imagery and exceptional use of the vocabulary and grammar. At the end of the meeting, I will report on grammar usage and suggest where I see improvements can be made.
What was the word again?
Ecstasy.
How do you spell that?
ECSTASY.
Thank you very much.
Hobbies bring joy, and excitement, ecstasy.
And so do putting puzzles together.
Passion.
Ecstasy.
So does putting puzzles together.
Mr. With Mr. Wizard of Oz.
Hey! Speaker searches for their next thought. I will also use note sentences strung together with bridge words like and or so, and will sound the buzzer when any of these infractions are heard. The fine for each infraction is 10 cents. Guest members who have not yet done their icebreaker will not be buzzed or fined.
Thank you. Let's go to Miss Emma Hancock.
Speaker, best tabletop speaker, best evaluator, and most improved speaker. I also suggest that everybody voting because
we're going to vote. Okay.
I will tally these results for award presentations at the end of the meeting. I will also pick up any comments you might have written for the speakers or any new participant and deliver the comments to the appropriate person. Thank you.
All right, really awesome. Thank you, Emma. Least. Our timer for this evening, in the left-hand corner, Mark Lockery.
Timer, a function filled with danger. Good thing I'm pumped up on all that ecstasy right now. As timer, I'm responsible for monitoring the time of each speaker, and I have Charlie down. Charlie's speech is actually three parts this evening. First part is 4 to 5 minutes. Second part, 4 to 5 minutes. And third part, 3 to 4 minutes. And Tony, I have you down for 7 to 10 minutes for your speech.
Thank you.
The green light will come on at range minimum, the yellow light at midpoint, and red light at range maximum. Table topics will be 1 to 2 minutes, and evaluations will be 2 to 3 minutes. Thank you, Adam.
And thank you, Mark. Let's hear it for Mark! Agenda today, which has a front and not a back. But there's a handout there. Those are going to be jigsaw puzzles, and that's for my speech, so hang on to that. Oh, and wait, on the back of, do you have the agendas that have something on the back? Okay, I picked up one that didn't. Okay, I just thought we'll take a look at that later. If not, this is a quote about writing, but it's so appropriate for those of us who are speaking, because speaking, you usually have to write it out first to think it write it, and it was so long, so we may not have time to go through it, but I wanted you to have a copy of the poem. So I thought that was very exciting. Next on our agenda are the speakers. This Toastmaster has made a goal to achieve Gold Toastmaster by the end of June. He is submitting two full books tonight that he has fulfilled. This project involves four parts, and it's a 10 to 14 minute speech. And I saw a text that said, I hope I get through this. Timer. Okay, you got the timing.
Yes.
All right. Giving a presentation. Well, before we do that, your evaluator is Gail. Gail, you want to read the objectives for this? Because this is a little bit more involved.
It is. Being a good conversationalist has a great impact on your personal and your professional lives. Every friendship and business relationship you have began with a conversation. Begin conversations with strangers by asking about the other person or commenting on your current mutual situation. Sorry, I don't have my glasses tonight. I'm trying to get to life. Listen carefully to the responses and ask appropriate follow-up questions. Questions that begin with what, how, or why will generate more information and more conversation opportunity. The objectives for Charlie, ideally identify techniques to use in conversing with strangers. Recognizing different levels of conversation, initiate a conversation with a stranger and use open-ended questions to solicit information for further conversation.
Thank you, Gail.
Yes.
A lot going on. And you have a volunteer? Is this interactive?
Stephen Block.
All right. So he'll be helping you. I'll let you call him up when you're ready. Please help me welcome Charlie Bondelier with the advanced speech. Guess who's coming to dinner?
Times, conversing with ease is not as simple as it seems. But if you plan properly, you can make it a very interesting and fun way to meet people. And I say people because I don't believe in the word strangers, because they're just friends we haven't met yet. If you have that set mind, that you are going to meet another friend today, it makes it easy. Let me explain to you why conversation has become a lot more simpler to me since I joined Toastmasters. I used to be very shy and very short of conversing with people because I didn't really trust people. But using all the techniques that Toastmasters has offered me throughout the 6 years that I've been here has shown me that putting in your mind that you are going to make friends, that everyone can learn something from you and you can learn from them. That makes it so much easier that today, one of the reasons, and there are people that can testify to this, is that I make friends when I go to work, and my job is to go to people's homes that I've never met before, and in some cases, some of the people are very rough. I go to trailer parks, rough apartments, and some nice homes also. But I have this thing now, that I walk with confidence, and I knock with confidence. And as soon as they open the door, I say, hi, how are you? My name is Charlie, what's your name? They give me their name. I have a question for you. I'm from Friends of Children and Family, and I want to know how I can be of service to you today. That opens the door immediately. They not only welcoming in, but they start talking, and I start asking questions because that's my job is to ask further questions. But I always start with an open-end question. It has taken me quite a while to progress myself to this point. The good news is that I feel myself getting better and better. Not only has it helped me with strangers, as you want to call them, but also with the children that I work with, because many of them are terrified when they see me. They have no clue who I am. They've never seen me before. And some of them are this little, and they see this big fat guy knocking on the door, and they know that I'm coming to see them, so they get afraid. So I have to make it easy for them. I have to go out of my way to smile at them, to shake their hands or high five, whatever makes them active towards being receptive to having an easy conversation with me. Because that's my job, is to have conversations with them and to make them feel better about themselves. Furthermore, it eases the parents when they see someone that can get down to the level of their children. So at times I'm very playful, and then there are times that I have to be serious with these children. But this just didn't come to me out of the blue sky. This came to me from learning and listening to each and every one of you Toastmasters that are here, and also the ones that are not here and travel in and out Toastmasters all the time. God forbid that I would not come to Toastmasters as often as I want to come, because this is a learning center. End of first part of the speech. There are techniques to learning and making yourself at ease first before you can make easy conversation with other people. And there are actually some skills that we have to learn slowly but surely. There are several objectives in conversing with ease. The first one would be considered the small talk. That usually begins with, how are you? My name is Charlie, what's your name? But those are very short small talks, because the danger there is if you don't give them an open-ended question, they're going to bombard you with yes and no answers, and you can never get going. No more than three of those short answers. So what's the ideal thing to do? Once you get past the point of your name, my name is Charlie, what's your name? What are you doing here? And then start with the open questions. The open questions are usually based on three factors: what, who, and where. I see you're wearing a New York shirt. Where are you from? They tell you New York. Says, well, from what part of New York? Are you living there now? Are you visiting? It opens up the conversation. The other one is, what brings you to this place? They have to give you a response. I work for this company, and I'm here for a meeting, or we're here for a party, whatever the case may be. The second stage of this, it's called fact disclosure. Once the initial small talk goes well, you may want to know your conversation partner better. So that means giving them small samples of yourself, not private ones, but just small ones. I work for Friends of Children and Family. What do you do? And then that opens more, man, because that now they feel more at ease that you just describe to them what you do, so they're going to tell you a little personal thing about themselves. Little by little, your conversation goes. Then, level three is where you start sharing viewpoints and opinions. This is the part that you have to be a little bit careful, because your viewpoints and opinions may not be theirs. So you have to treat it with kindness. You can't be a bull in a china shop, but be flexible. You have a right to your opinions, but everything can be done in a nice manner. If you can get through part three, guess what? You just made a friend. Because that's going to lead you into part four. You both disclose feelings of more personal level. This is a time that you can actually, without giving your social security and address to this person, you can say something like, wow, you know, I'm really having problems with one of my kids, and I'm afraid for their future, and I'm not sure how to handle this. And they respond, well, I have a little boy too, and he goes crazy, jumping up and down, and we try to avoid that, and don't want him to get hurt. Now, you've become friendly. Now you have a bond. And that's the most important thing, is to have a bond with someone. If you have a bond, respect comes in. They're gonna respect your views, and you should respect theirs. At this time, I want you to remember one thing. Your first few questions will most likely require an early yes and no. Best to ask open-ended questions. Remember the three: what, how, or why. This is the end of the second section. Tonight I've asked Stephen Clark to be my stranger. So I'm going to ask him now to come up here, if you will. And the scenario is going to be that we're both in a shopping grocery store buying groceries. And he's in front of me. He has one or two small items, and I have a basket full of items. So when I see him coming, I let him go first. And I notice, come on, oh, I love your Miami Dolphins t-shirt. Are you a fan?
Oh, thanks. I got this shirt at a convention, but I go to a lot of games.
Do you live here in Orlando, or do you live in Miami?
I live here in Orlando.
Well, you used to go to the games all the time?
Every once in a while.
Yeah, me too. I love the Miami Dolphins. I went to their first game they ever had, and I got lucky enough to be able to go to one of the games that they won the championship in 1972 when they went undefeated. By the way, my name is Charlie. What's your name?
Steve.
Steve, nice meeting you.
Same here.
Listen, I noticed you got a frozen food in there. That's all you're eating tonight?
For tonight it is.
Oh, you're not having a big deal or anything, a big meal with your family?
Nah, they're out of town.
Oh. Look at my basket. You know why my basket is full?
You must have a party.
Yes, I have three daughters that are coming to my house, and a couple other friends that want to see them, so now I have a ton of people coming.
Are they pretty?
Oh, they're beautiful. Listen, put that away. You want to come to our house tonight?
Hey, anytime I can be a beautiful lady.
I live not far from here. You don't live far from here, do you?
Nah, just a few blocks down.
Good meeting you. I'll see you. Let me give you the address. We'll walk to the car, and I'll give you my address and phone number.
That's great.
Thank you.
Bye.
you notice, I try to give an open-ended questions. You have to know that once you get past those three little short yes or no, it's time to open up. The more you practice this, the easier it gets. And that's why I'm really proud of myself, and I'm really happy that I don't have a problem with people like I used to have. I do Toastmasters with prisoners. Some of these dudes are rough, but I go up to them and I shake their hand. What are you doing, man? Well, how long are you gonna be here? And they answer me now. Hopefully they don't kill me, but they never have. They're always, if you become friendly with them, they become friendly with you. And you know what? It's a great pleasure to meet these people. Because I have learned, I used to be afraid of prisoners thinking, you know, they don't want to talk to me, they're druggies or something. They're human beings. You never know who you're going to run into that will lighten your life. And you never know whose life you're going to lighten up. So I say to you, converse with ease and be confident. Man of the Toastmaster.
Comments to Charlie. That was quite a job. That was outstanding.
Your objectives are to collect the information, formulate them, and support the points that you want to make with the examples, facts, and circumstances that you are going to present to us.
Thank you. And that's project number 7, research, your topic. Research. Mm-hmm. It'll be presented by Tony Gittles, your friend and mine, who is, as mentioned,
Captain
Jigsaw Puzzle, Night and day.
You shake hands with her?
Yes, I will shake hands with her. Please welcome Tony Hill. What do you do for fun? How do you relax? What's your passion when you aren't working? Well, we know Gail drinks wine. John Dunn watches motivational tapes and reads books. And Tony Giddles puts jigsaw puzzles together. Now you know. But you know, I don't know if any of you are jigsaw puzzle fans. I've never gone around asking, Charlie, do you put jigsaw puzzles together?
Zero.
Zero. Charlie, do you know what a jigsaw puzzle is?
Yes.
All right. Does everybody know what a jigsaw puzzle is?
Yes.
All right. Has anybody put, other than Charlie, then, put a jigsaw puzzle together any time in their life?
Yes.
It could have been at age 3, which is when my mother said I put my first puzzle together, and she knew I had a talent. Let's get into some of the research first, and then I want to have some fun and show you some of the work I've done. And you all have puzzles on your table, so we're going to look at those as well. Anybody know how far back jigsaw puzzles go? What year?
2.
Well, it's not that old.
4.
Question, okay. 1760, which I thought was far enough back. You know, that was a surprise. John Spilsbury, a London cartographer and engraver, is credited with commercializing the jigsaw puzzle. And all of this, a lot of this information is from Wikipedia, and then some of the research I did on some of the puzzle company sites as well. They were originally created by painting a picture, but on a rectangular piece of wood, and then cutting the picture into the pieces with, guess what, a jigsaw. Hence the name, although according to the article, the name jigsaw puzzle didn't come into being over 100 years later, in 1880. Thought that was interesting. Jigsaw puzzles soared in popularity during the Depression. Why do you think that? They were inexpensive.
People no jobs.
Long-lasting. Takes time to put one together. And they could share them. They could recycle them with other people. Modern jigsaw puzzles are not, you can find some made out of wood. They're made out of paperboard, though, since they're easier and cheaper to mass produce. New technology has enabled laser cutting, which is really fascinating. I put a lot of puzzles together, and if you put some together with the standard cutout pieces, there are some today that have amazing shapes. They're not boring, they're not repetitive, they're fascinating to put together and to match the pieces together. So, Gail, you put together a puzzle. What's the picture of?
Of the puzzle?
Yeah.
It was,
what would it be?
It was of a marine scene.
All right.
The wildlife.
Okay, Gloria, what about your puzzle?
The last time I did this one was with a little girl, and it was Mickey Mouse.
All right, let's hear it for Mickey Mouse.
Yay.
Well, typical images are from nature, buildings, animals. We've got a lot of Disney stuff, a lot of stuff for children today. Repetitive designs, collages, cottages, and so on. Anything. According to the website seriouspuzzles.com, which I visited for many hours this weekend, you will find 47 different categories of puzzles. So if it's sports or transportation or cars or baseball, you got a puzzle there for you. In addition, on that website, they distributed puzzles from 42 other puzzle manufacturing companies. I had no idea there were so many puzzles to be had. I will shortly be the proud owner of about 15 new puzzles. Hazard of the trade. Jigsaw puzzles typically come in 300, 500, 750, 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 pieces. So I've been working mostly with 500, 550, 750, and 1,000 because of the time frame in putting them together and because I have yet to have a big enough table to do anything greater than that. However, the largest commercial puzzle, who wants to take a guess? How many pieces it has? Think 30, big.
1,000.
50,000.
32,000.
Wow.
256 pieces. All right. Whew, that must have taken about 800 people to put it together. A few puzzles, believe it or not, if you're not a fan, a real fan, are double-sided.
Oh.
However, when you empty the box, you don't know which piece is for which side. Okay, there's a challenge I'm not taking up yet.
Wow.
I've also heard of puzzles that have no picture on the box. So you don't even know what you're getting into. Now, I love the pictures on the box, and I love to match the pieces, and I love to enjoy the picture while I'm putting it together. There's family puzzles, so if you have children, which you do, there's puzzle pieces that have different sizes. They start large in the middle, and then the pieces get smaller, and families can put them together. So there's plenty of companies that do that, like Springbok, Cobble Hill, Ravensburger, Suns Out make this type of specialty puzzle. Now, I was recently at Walmart and Target, not realizing, boy, you can buy puzzles in the store, because I've been shopping online for a long time. And I got introduced to some new companies, which I'll share with you, well, which are on your handouts. There's also three-dimensional puzzles. I mean, puzzles have gone wild. So if this interests you at all, there's a lot of fun you can have if this is something that you're inclined to do. And those of you who are computer freaks, I understand there's jigsaw puzzles on the computer, no mess, you don't lose any pieces. Yeah. I didn't have time to look into that. I like the mess on my living room table. I like touching and, you know, that's not me. I'll check it out someday. Most of the puzzles I've been working with are square or rectangular, but there are round ones, and there are other puzzles that are in the shape of an object, like an animal, in the shape of a cat. I haven't gone there either, but I've seen some very pretty ones that look kind of fun. According to the Alzheimer's Society, so a little potential Alzheimer's prevention for Gail and myself and Charlie, maybe Gloria, okay? According to the Alzheimer's Society of Canada, doing jigsaw puzzles is one of many activities that may help keep the brain active and many may contribute to reducing the risk of developing Alzheimer's. Another thing, and some of you may know this, that the jigsaw puzzle piece is the logo for the Autism Society. It was first started in 1963 in the United Kingdom because they said of the puzzling nature of autism and the inability to fit in due to social differences and because jigsaw puzzles were recognizable. If you've been on Wikipedia, they use a jigsaw puzzle globe with empty pieces to add room for knowledge. So let's have some fun here. This is a puzzle that, the only puzzle I've kept from 1968, it's copyright. One of the things I love about it is the color. It's actually not really challenging because the pieces are gonna be very obvious looking, the colors are easy to sort. And one of the things I love about this puzzle, and part of it is together, but the pieces are very thick, they're very solid, they interlock really well. So I enjoy that. I bought some inexpensive puzzles that just kind of, you have trouble putting them together because they keep falling apart. So this is one of my favorite ones that I keep, and I probably put it together about 10 or 20 times. Take out your puzzles. And I'm gonna go through the process that I go through when I put a puzzle together. And I'm gonna use this lady as an example. I actually finished this last night when I should have been writing my speech. So one of the first things I do, and you can play along with me because these are 24-piece puzzles, is find all of the edges. So make the frame. And this is just my system. People do it different ways, but it's very typical that you would put the frame together first because they're straight edges and they're easily identifiable. Then I would sort all of the pieces, or most of the pieces, by color. So this one was fairly easy to pick out the blue. That really stood out. There's some blue over here. The orange, you know, now I'm looking at the box. And the turquoise color over here. The blue. And as I start to put it together, I put the frame together, but then I start with the pieces that are obvious. Like I put the blue together. And then I worked up this section. The hardest part was the wings, because there were a lot of pieces, and it looked like it was going to be difficult to put together. It wasn't as challenging as I thought, but I have a very good eye for shape, for the shades of the colors. Everybody's a little different, but that's gonna be hanging in my bedroom. This is another one which I've put together recently. I'm into fantasy things, and this is called Magical World. And again, when you look at a puzzle, when I look at it, sometimes I want a real challenge, sometimes I just want to enjoy the beauty of the puzzle. Sometimes, you know, it's the colors. So in this one, there's a lot of gold in it and there's a lot of blue, but there's a lot of different shades. So again, before I get macular degeneration, I'm going to put together a lot of puzzles, because you really need good vision to separate pieces. But again, you can see there's animals. There's a couple of these. I don't know what they're called. We've got boats. You know, so you've got a lot going on here. By the way, if you're just getting started, one thing you can do is purchase a multi-pack set. There's 100-piece, 300-piece, and 500-piece puzzles. And they're really very reasonable. There's 10 jigsaw puzzles in here. So some you can finish in an hour, some will take a couple of days. And here's a couple of others that you can look at later, because I'm running out of time. But it gives you, this was John's favorite, I showed him some pictures. So happy jigsaw puzzling, and I hope you got your puzzle together. If not, I'm happy to help you. Madam Toastmaster. Okay, 1 minute on the timers. Clock for some comments.
And voting?
And we'll, let's get a timers report so we can also vote. Timers report?
Oh, you want an hour?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, but we'll still take the minute.
Charlie Bombalier qualifies with 4 minutes and 38 seconds for section one, 5 minutes and 14 seconds for section two, 3 minutes and 44 seconds for section three. Tony Gills qualifies at 10 minutes, 29 seconds. Both qualifies for the Golden Ribbon.
Yay!
Thank you. So finish your comments. Please vote for your favorite speaker, and everybody please vote. Charlie, you vote for me, and I'll vote for you.
Sure, it works that way.
No, I usually vote for myself.
1 minute!
All right, thank you. 1 minute on the clock. So, we're running a little bit late. And let's see, I'll have another chance to get up here with my longer quote. Here's a quote from, is this the same guy, Jared Kintz. He's pretty good, isn't he? He's got a lot of interesting things to say. What do I do for fun? He says, well, I'd love to get into the bank robbing business, but government work isn't for me.
You heard that before.
Have you heard that before?
Yes.
Okay, so let's explore the topic of hobbies I love a little bit more with our Table Topics Master. As a young boy in rural Ohio, he collected comic books, and as we know, G.I. Joe's. If he would have had the foresight to keep everything in good condition, he might be a very rich man today. You can see by looking at him that he didn't think that far ahead. Please welcome our Table Topics Master this evening, Mark Lockery.
Thank you, Madam Toastmaster. None of us are guests. We all know what Table Topics is about. And since we're kind of short on personnel tonight, I'm going to call on people that already have speaking roles. But if I call on you and you don't want to participate because you're busy with your evaluation or whatever, just let me know and I will kindly move on to somebody else. A hobby is a regular activity that is done for enjoyment, typically during one's leisure. Hobbies can include collecting themed items and objects, engaging in creative and artistic pursuits, playing sports, or other amusements. Please tell us about a hobby that would involve the use of binoculars. Roy.
Woo-hoo!
I was going to say, does
fishing.
Does the beach count?
Yeah, because you can look at
the I think board. I'd probably get in trouble with that with my wife. Binoculars. I think someone nailed it right on the head. What could be more exciting and just pure ecstasy other than bird watching? There's nothing more fascinating. I'm in the process of moving right now, and in the backyard, it's just nothing but woods, conservation area. And the one thing that I can't look forward to more is to sit back on my patio in a nice Adirondack chair
and just bird watch. But I need to get myself a nice pair of binoculars so I can see that beak and those eyes up close and really keep track of what those guys are doing throughout the trees. I mean, it's just absolutely fascinating. Yeah, my kids might want to play puzzles. You know, my wife might want to watch a show or something like that, but I will be bird watching. It's my passion. There's nothing more fun than that. Outside of, let's see, checking out the scenery at the beach and bird watching, the only other thing I can think of with binoculars as a little kid is the football games. Going to an NFL game, I used to always go to the Redskins game with my stepfather, and he always brought a pair of binoculars with him. And there's nothing like, hey Roy, you want to check out what's going on in the game? And then putting those binoculars on and getting right up at the bench and seeing the players up close. As a kid, those guys, for whatever reason, are your heroes. So just thinking back, that's really where my head was. But now it's all about bird watching. Mr. Tabletop.
Well, I've never been so anxious to go out and watch birds as I am right now. Thanks for that. Many hobbies involve sports or activities. Name an outdoor hobby that you enjoy doing, Emma.
Basketball is one of the things I really loved, but I stopped playing it. One reason, my shoulder. The other reason, the coach. The coach literally told me, you're not good enough to play. I was out of every game, almost every game that season. Like two games I was playing, and it was not fun. You know that I was playing because I was slow, always traveled. When I went to every practice, but most of them, but to every other practice or so. I was at every practice. I don't know what it was. I don't know why I didn't think I was good enough. I don't know anything. But I do love basketball and I like playing in my spare time. Just doing that is quite a lot of fun in my spare time and not having to deal with coaches or anything like that. Thank you.
Young, for some reason, I collected belt buckles. I only had one belt and over 50 buckles to put on. I don't know why I did that. Name something or tell us something that you were interested in collecting when you were young, Gloria.
Something that I used to collect when I was younger. Mr. Tabletopics Master, that would be Hallmark ornaments. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, and that's where the office of Hallmark is. And way back in 1970, I want to say maybe 4 or 5, way back when, they used to throw them away. And I had friends that worked at Hallmark, mm-hmm. and they would bring me bags of these ornaments. And they were really unique, they were different, they were movable. A lot of bulbs, they don't call them bulbs, Christmas bulbs, yeah. And they had the signs and they had years and everything, and so it was really, really nice. I still collect them. I have all my daughters from the first Christmas all the way until, I think they stop at like the 7th or 8th Christmas. Now I buy a daughter every year. I got first home, I mean, you name it, I have it. Now I have two trees in my house. I have one for all the kind of comical things, and then my other one is just the angels or anything that has to do with Christmas, the real Christmas. And I also love to collect nativity scenes. I have a lot of nativity scenes from made out of toothpicks all the way into something really, really fancy. My goal is to get a Yondra, but I'm going to have to put that on the list somewhere. Mr. Tabletop Master.
Thank you. together model airplanes or model rockets or building things. Have you ever built anything? Stephen Block.
Okay.
As an engineer, I built lots of things. I remember my junior project in college. I'm trying to remember what it is now. It was a curve tracer. And it plotted the voltage curve. As you applied more voltage across a diode or a resistor, you ended up with more current, more power. The voltage and the current were usually proportional to each other for something passive. For something solid state, you ended up with a curve. There was a lot of programming involved. These were the days when I heavily used the basic programming language. The electronic part, the analog part, was difficult because we had to make a 30-volt signal work with 15-volt op-amps without having to destroy them. Once we got the analog portion working, the code was a lot easier. We got to see the curves, the nice little curves, slowly move across the screen on the old CRT manager. I did not have advanced programming tools back then, so I had to manipulate each pixel individually. These days, I can more efficiently generate a curve with a built-in toolkit. But back then, it was amazing. I could control the horizontal and the vertical. I could set any pixel to any color that I wanted. I just could not scale the display. At the end of the term, my curve tracer was placed in the rack, a display with other groups' projects. Somebody had the laser guitar. Somebody had the virtual oscilloscope. But it was rewarding at the end of the term to see my project fully functional. Thank you, Mr. Tabletop.
Gloria, may we get a timer's report, please, for our tabletop speakers this evening?
Yes, we may. Ward spoke about bird watching, hint, hint, at 1 minute 32 seconds, and he qualified. Emma spoke about her being the Miss Michael Jordan, 1 minute and 14 seconds, and she qualifies. I spoke about collections, Hallmark, 1 minute and 33 seconds, I qualified. And Stephen talked about a complicated engineering hobby, 2 minutes and 12 seconds, and he qualifies. Everyone
calls. Please vote for best tabletop speaker. At this point, I would like to bring Tony Gittles back to the lecture.
How are you doing with your puzzles? Anybody put it together? Emma's working feverishly over there.
I'm out of time.
By the way, this is White Mountain Puzzles. Now, the puzzles I showed you here, the two large ones, came from there, and this, there's a whole catalog of really fascinating puzzles. And for Cyber Monday, they gave me a free puzzle.
Oh, wow.
And I had enough points that I'd earned another free puzzle.
Wow.
So watch out. You don't want to come to my house and be overwhelmed by puzzles. Some people don't like cats. If you're afraid of puzzles, I also wanted to tell you, here's an idea if you ever get into it. I have a friend from Chicago that comes down here every year to visit me, and I put together this Florida puzzle. It's 1,000 pieces, and I bought a frame that was slightly larger, and on the top of the puzzle and on the bottom, I put pictures of us at Legoland and in Mount Dora and all the travels. So she's coming down in February, so that's a surprise for her. And that's the same person that does the antique toys, so I think she's going to be surprised. All right, to wrap up hobbies, another quote that I was very impressed with. Keep creating new chapters in your personal book and never stop reinventing and perfecting yourself. Try new things. Pick up new hobbies and books. Travel and explore other cultures. I like to never stay in the same city or state for more than 5 years. There are many heavens on earth waiting for you to discover. Seek out people with beautiful hearts and minds, not those with just beautiful style and bodies. The first kind will remain forever beautiful to you, while the other will grow stale and ugly. Learn a new language at least twice. Change your career at least thrice, and change your location often. Like all creatures in the wild, we were designed to keep moving. And it goes on. Nobody will ever reach perfection in this lifetime, but trying to achieve it is a full-time job. Start now and don't stop. Make your book of life a musical. Never abandon obligations, but have fun leaving behind a colorful legacy. Never allow anybody to be the composer of your own destiny. Take control of your life and never allow limitations implanted by society tell you how your music is supposed to sound or how your book is supposed to be written. Our general evaluator is new to the task, but always enjoys the challenge and opportunity to achieve. Please welcome Stephen Block to the lectern.
Thank you, Tony Giddos, for the ecstasy of being able to put together a puzzle. I probably should have been spending more time focusing on my speech for the general evaluation and what everybody spoke about. I got a little sidetracked. I'm surprised I didn't start earlier, but I'm sure I don't have all of your full attention either. Our next evaluator, got to call it an order.
First is Gail.
Okay, let's see. So Gail did Charlotte, right?
Yes.
Since 1951, our next evaluator states that her number one hobby is eating. Who doesn't like to eat? This favorite hobby all started when her mother and father would hover anchovies over her mouth as she sat in her high chair. It was purported, I don't know what that word is, that she had eaten so many in her young life when her mother sat around the floor, her roily poly tummy completely covered her legs.
Roly poly.
This fact is probably why she runs so she can eat. She lifts weights so she can eat. She cooks so she can eat. That statement is true. She dances so she can eat. And she talks so she can eat. Please welcome distinguished Toastmaster Gail Hill-Smith.
I have to admit, despite the many years I have been involved with Toastmasters, Charlie, this was a complex project that you tackled, giving me a very complex job as evaluator. The manual broke his project into five parts, and he achieved and fulfilled all five of those parts. For your evaluation purpose, I'm going to focus on the scenario part because I believe that pulls in many of the suggestions that were mentioned in your manual. Conversing with ease. As we heard, Charlie opened with a speech in order to tell us more about the importance of an effective conversation, giving us illustrations, personal stories, to demonstrate the effectiveness of conversation and how he has become more fluid as a conversationalist because of Toastmasters. Then he transitioned into more description of the techniques around conversation, how you build from level to level. And one of the primary techniques was to ask open-ended questions in a situation that you are in. open-ended questions, meaning that the person that you're conversing with is not going to simply give you a yes, no answer. Then you led us into the scenario. How well did the speaker explain the value of conversational skills and the different conversational techniques? Not only did you explain them well, but you demonstrated them well. When you approached this complete stranger, you opened up with a sincere compliment, which was recommended in the book. And I believe all of you have probably done that with a stranger. Give a sincere compliment. And in this case, it was about the t-shirt. Then it led into the next level of conversation, which his manual describes, where you seek facts. Well, he noticed there was a small amount of food in the cart, which led an easy transition into, oh, do you cook for yourself? Is it for family? Which ultimately led and transitioned into an invitation to dinner. If there was one area in the speech I would recommend not to do, and Match.com, in fact, advises this. Speed dating. I don't know if I would have been quite that quick to invite a complete stranger for dinner. But you've met your goals, you had your objectives, you allowed your audience to see and witness and hear a very well-spoken and demonstrated conversation. Mr. General Evaluator.
Thank you, Gail. Now that I've finished my puzzle, I can focus on the puzzle. Our next speaker is excited about evaluations. Great. Amazing. Tony Giddle's speech. And one of her favorite hobbies, jigsaw puzzles. This evaluator will comment on all the parts and pieces of the speech that fit and point out any missing or misplaced pieces. Please welcome to the lectern our very own Jay Majors!
Great to see everyone, my fellow Toastmasters tonight. We're a small group, but happy to see you all. Tony, an amazingly fun speech, as always. Your speeches are always upbeat. They always draw us in. They always catch our attention. I love jigsaw puzzles. Grew up doing them. Grew up showing my daughter, doing puzzles with my daughter, even at her age now. So we enjoy doing those puzzles. I found so many interesting facts throughout your whole speech. You kind of drew us in. You opened up with a question that got our attention and also tied it into the group. How many people have done jigsaw puzzles? That made it appropriate for the group because there you knew everybody understood where you were going. It fits our topic tonight, hobbies. What a fabulous hobby. I was drawn in by all the interesting facts in the history. I remember doing puzzles when I was a girl that were made out of wood, and you probably do also. I enjoyed some of the most when you talked about how it's used for brain development. And I know they use it in a lot of the elder facilities and places like that, especially for therapy. And when you said the autism has a puzzle as their logo, I didn't know this. I haven't paid attention to any of it. I don't know who else has. So it was very interesting that stuff that goes on in our world every day, we didn't know. So thank you for pointing all of those facts out. Your speech was well researched, I think primarily on the internet, but also from your personal experience. I love your demonstrations and actually giving us puzzles to work on and to do. You took us down the path to get there. The areas that I think could do a little help with, I didn't actually hear a specific intent or point or purpose, but it developed as it went along. And it was open to interpretation, I think, for everybody in the room. So that could be either way. The one thing about having us open the puzzles toward the end is it could be seen as a distraction. We all got more into the puzzle instead of hearing the last part of your speech, and whatever strong point that you might have been trying to make there may have been overshadowed by people playing with the puzzle. But I loved it. I loved that part regardless because I love puzzles. So those would be my areas that I would say before you do something like that, think about how it affects your audience and what you want to say at the end of your speech. Maybe let them take it home and leave them with a challenge. Leave them with a challenge to do it. Just a thought. But overall, loved it. And I really thank you, Tony.
I was searching my phone to try to find the GPS route of a race that I ran. I think either in 2012 or 2013, it was actually an autism sponsored race. And what was interesting is you looked at the GPS and it showed a pattern of a puzzle piece through whatever neighborhood that was run. I'll try to find it and print that for next time. May we have a timer support now?
Sorry, I was distracted. Yes, Mr. Judge Evaluator. Gail gave an excellent evaluation, however. She came in at 3 minutes and 45 seconds. She does not qualify.
You did a Gloria.
Jay came in at 3 minutes and 28 seconds, so she does qualify.
Okay, so 1 minute on the clock for everybody to vote for.
There's no need to vote.
One clock. Did anybody have everybody hand in their vote for the best table topic?
Yes.
Because I didn't remember.
Also, most improved, we can do most improved. Well, wait for most improved. Let everybody get another opportunity.
Emma, go around. Next functionary, I will call the odd counter. Who's the odd counter for tonight?
That's the one.
Can I get an
odd
counter report?
Yes, you may. So, Charlie, I have four bridge words from your speech. Good job. Tony, I've got two odds and ohms, and I've got six bridge words. Some you know sprinkled in there. Emma, I had one odd ohm. You had that ohm in the beginning, and then you slowed down, and I thought you did a great job throughout the rest of your topics. Gloria, one two bridge words. I caught an for myself, and I'm sure many more, but I caught it right when I said it, so that's good. Stephen Block, I had two double clutches and one bridge word. Gail, one bridge word. And Jay, three bridge words, three ends.
Right.
Grammarian.
Word of the day, I had Tony, Mark, Charlie, myself, and Steven try to make it a little challenging. got a couple people there. And in terms of grammar and colorful phrases, Charlie can't be a bull in a china shop. I saw you and Jay arguing earlier that night, and I never mind. Gail, I liked your Match.com reference. Stephen butchered Roly Poly. And Jay, I think I heard you say doing puzzles instead of doing puzzles. You got it right
do
there.
It. Like a southern
dude. I know what you're saying. I just got to call it out. Just got to call it out. That's all I
have. Bring us out.
Our board counter doesn't need to speak, but if we could fill out for these, if you could all write in the most improved, that would help.
If we're Southern speaking, that's all I got. That's pretty good.
Yeah. We don't have any guests today. I don't believe.
Evaluate the meeting.
So I will evaluate the meeting.
Yeah.
This meeting was smaller than usual, yet cozy. Most of us sat together on one side of the room. We had a little bit of a delay getting the meeting started. However, we did get the meeting started. We had what I believe to be a successful meeting. All the speakers spoke. Our normal speakers were two veteran speakers. I wasn't able to find any mistakes on their part because they've been speaking for a lot longer than I did. It was interesting how Charlie had an interactive speech, something that could be applied as a real life skill. It's obviously harder when you try to do it in real life and when you don't brief ahead of time. But we're in Toastmasters and we don't want the conversation to fall apart. Tony shared one of her hobbies, something that I enjoy, and I thank you again for the puzzle. For our table topics, Mark was very entertaining. He gave us good questions. I don't remember everybody's answers because I was preoccupied with the puzzles back then. I won't even try to remember what everybody spoke about.
That was how I kept you all awake.
I was also focusing on how am I going to be Toastmaster for this. So I was distracted there. But for the most part, the best piece of information to learn is something that Charlie mentioned in his speech, is that he goes to Toastmasters as often as he can, because this is a learning experience. This is where we improve. This is where we get better. And every time I come here, I learn something new. What I plan to do is take what I've learned from this meeting. I'm assuming everybody else is going to do the same. We're going to take what we learned from this meeting and we're going to apply it to be more successful people, to be happier people. And with that, I thank you all for attending. Do we have any club business?
Yeah, turn it over to Charlie.
I will turn this over to Charlie.
Sunday, I'm going to visit two little girls that have issues. We do respite for babysitting. And I didn't open that puzzle because I need one more to take you.
No problem. You're a good man.
Because they were really enjoying it.
No problem. You're a good man.
Okay, thank you. I knew I could count on Tony.
Yes. Yeah, I'll say too, if you'd like, take your puzzles on. There might be extras if you have kids, some of you do, or pass them along to your children or grandchildren. where did I get those? Target, but it's got to be a big Target. I didn't see it at my smaller one in Lake Mary. $10 for 12 puzzles.
Oh, so wow, that's
such
good.
A deal. So if you take a puzzle, it's $1. No.
Yeah.
my contribution to the
It's actually 90 cents.
And I think I spent $70 on this, unfortunately.
And Tony, you know what? This actually would be good.
good for middle school and high school because, especially if they have emotional problems,
yeah.
It's just, well, it's kind of relaxing.
If you need help with your puzzle, I'll help you.
I always take a couple pieces out before I give the puzzle to my kids, and they'll get their expression. That's fun.
You're so mean.
Okay, that's past the
agenda for next
week.
It was supposed to be going around, and it started right there. It started.
It got as far as there.
How far did it get? I'm sorry, I was so distracted. We still got people doing puzzles.
Okay, my mom's
good. All right, I got it.
They're going to be good the next week, by the way, but I am not.
Okay, we're good. All right, so we're done with December 2nd. We've got a Toastmaster, Steve.
That's the plan.
Is Toastmaster. And Gail, you want to connect with him? You offered some coaching.
Sure.
Some help on that and preparing the agenda. We have two speakers. We have Jay Majors and Jonathan Dunn. So we have a general evaluator, Mark Lockery. We need evaluators.
I'll be evaluator.
So, Charlie, Roy, are you going to be here? You want to do table topics? I'm not sure.
Yeah, I just don't want to commit to it.
Okay.
Just yet.
So, Charlie, table topics, anybody? Lori, can you come back?
I will and I don't.
We'll put Susan down.
Yeah, they'll be back next week.
They'll be back next week. I'm not going to be
and
here.
Steven said he'll be in the evaluator.
Oh, okay.
I'm just saying.
I think I heard that.
Mr. Texas. Really
great one. Steve Morgan?
Yeah, he said he's willing to double up too. So.
Yeah, he can double up. All right.
He said he'll do the evaluator.
I found my piece.
All right, we'll work that out. Okay, that's working.
Mark took it out.
Okay, any questions? Yeah. And the 16th, Gail, do you want to say any more about the banquet?
No, other than
and next week is the election, so please come. We need you to vote. It's Robert's Rules of Order, and we have a procedure to do that, and you'll hear some speeches. Gail, go.
Do you have any idea if Susan is going to be sending out a nice invitation to take reservations?
Well, she's the chair, so why don't you go? Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
It's going to be here.
It's in this room. We do have chairs for all the things, the trophies, and I'll be letting you. When we know who's the winner, I'll be asking for volunteers to present the trophies and give you information like I always do. What else? We've got a keynote speaker. We've got somebody coming to do the induction. we're really pretty far along. But Susan's the main contact if any of you are cheering.
Attire?
Well, nobody's mentioned it. I'd like to dress up because it's too hot.
I want to come as Kiss again.
Too hot in
Kiss.
I say, come as you are. Come as you feel like I'm we don't know. Let's discuss it with Susan. I know my mom would like to dress up in a spot or something.
Yeah,
yeah.
I think usually we do.
Like semi-formal.
Is this a holiday banquet or an awards banquet?
Well, it's an awards banquet.
Similar to what we did last time?
We do it in June.
Is that June?
Every 6 months, yeah. Every 6 months.
Yeah, that was the last meeting you were at, Lori.
You know, the purpose of it.
I hosted it, right? Isn't that when I hosted it?
And then you left for 6 months.
The purpose of it is to acknowledge people's attaining participation from the membership.
Right, yeah, okay.
And give some speeches. We'll have an incoming speech and an outgoing speech. You know, it's all about speeches. Hey, it's about speaking.
I'm getting a lot of cheers on that one.
Wait till you're ready.
Are you finished?
Delayed a little bit here for a couple minutes. Okay. I want to ask, is everyone going to be with your family in town on Christmas?
I'm out of town.
You're going out of town?
Yeah.
What are you going to go see?
I'm going to go see my grandchildren.
Oh, wow.
And take a couple of these puzzles.
And do a couple of, take the puzzles. Gloria, what are you going to be doing?
I'm going to go visit my daughter in Texas.
Oh, really? Yeah. Is that the one I met?
I
It's the one that's in front of your residency.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's the one I met on one side.
She's a Gator girl.
Oh, she is? Well,
she was crying.
Tell her I cried for her when the Sentinels kicked me butt.
I know. They forgot to show up.
I have a question for you, Gloria. I mean, not Gloria, I'm sorry.
Gail.
I'm sorry, I have a quick question for you.
Yeah.
I just want to know, how many towels did you use last Saturday when FSU...
Oh, yeah.
The Gators.
I will tell you that I was at a sports bar, first of all, the Central Florida alumni group gathered, and there were probably 60 to 70 of us. Third quarter, I admit I left the sports bar, and I was waiting for the end of the game.
Oh,
did not know the score. Yeah. My son-in-law, who graduated from FSU,
let me send an email tomorrow.
Told me in an email.
Okay.
Actually, I thought about you watching the game.
I know.
I had a smile on my face.
You know what? For the schedule next week, topic, let's get the theme again. Let me get it.
May the force be with you.
Okay.
Ooh, that's a good topic.
And force.
I figured it was going to be a long
time. Anybody for thought and pledge? Who's in the room? No. Okay.
I'll do thought.
You want to do it?
Yeah.
All right. I think we're pretty good here. Rory, you're maybe for governor.
Yeah, I
should I take you off?
As long as it's something that can be doubled up in case I can't be good.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, I'm moving, in the process of moving.
Oh,
so
okay.
Yeah, been,
so. I did that a few months ago.
Yeah. That's excusable.
Okay.
Okay.
Are we done? We're done. Time for the awards. For the Tim Chastain Award, my pleasure to present this to Mr. Stephen Block. We have a new special awards, a little different shape than this, but this is for the most improved award tonight, Emma Hancock. For the best table topics award, Stephen Block.
Woo! Wow.
For the best evaluator award, it was close, Jay Mason.
Tales on Monday, and then in January, the Division D is having a Division D Tall Tale contest.
Oh, really?
Oh. Tall Tale.
Yes. Does anybody remember seeing that?
Yeah.
You did.
Yeah.
So it was sent out from the club. Okay.
Is that it?
Yes, sir. I just wanted to thank several of you who stepped up at the last minute to pull tonight's meeting off. I was kind of watching, and I'm like, I can't do it, but I'm glad several of you did, so thank you.
Absolutely. With that note, meeting adjourned.
Please clean up and put the table.